I've got the high honor to sit here with David Marcus today, and I mean that because we've just gotten to know each other literally this morning. David, you've got a very, very interesting career that's kind of a bit backwards from how the world works. You've run 4 startups. Your first one you told me was you took on Swiss Telecom and you built a wireline company, and you ran 4 companies, and you sold your last company to PayPal, and now you're running PayPal, which is moving from the millions to the billions. Talk about how that is going and how you made that transition.
Well, it's definitely very, very different. And you know, in startups, it's all about speed, it's all about execution, you're hands-on with every single part of the business. Whereas in a company like PayPal, which now has 13,000 employees, it's about culture, it's about talent, and it's about influencing and driving innovation. But it's very different. But it's truly a fascinating time to run PayPal now.
How do you get 13,000 people to move quickly?
Well, first of all, you need to organize appropriately, and we took steps to do that. We had 9 different product groups. We merged those into one. We split them into very small, agile teams of talented designers, engineers, and product managers, and we enabled them to iterate very, very quickly with the proper tools and platforms, which wasn't the case before. And that accelerates quite a bit. Not quite startup speed just yet, but a lot better.
When we were getting to know each other this morning and I was reflecting on what you told me, the one thing that stuck in my mind was you told me that at PayPal, you've got the team working what I'll call startup hours.
Yes.
How are you doing that?
Well, that's something that I already found joining PayPal, and that was really amazing, is that I found people working weekends, late nights, and we have a lot of really hardworking people. But they were fighting the system. It's just, you know, they kept on saying how hard it was to get things done. And I think that if we apply the same effort, but just organize in a more efficient way, we can just produce much better results, and that's what we're trying to do now.
So PayPal is on a roll. Mm-hmm. You just had your 2012 earnings results. Mm-hmm. Donovan, I think, said that mobile is going to change the face of e-commerce. Mm-hmm. Your numbers were, you tripled mobile payments from what, high 3 billions to?
Yeah, so after I sold my company to PayPal, I first took over mobile. And at that time, we closed the year 2011 at $3.9 billion of mobile payment volume. And in 2012, we just did $14 billion. So it's an explosive growth that we're seeing on mobile, and I feel it's only the beginning.
Have you given any guidance that you can talk about for what 13 looks like?
We gave a guidance at about $20 billion, and that's remote payments. This year, we're going to move into physical world payments, in-store payments with PayPal, and that's not including those numbers that will come and add to that $20 billion number.
So I think everybody accepts that payments for online are probably going to be mostly mobile, and that's a given. Mm-hmm. As being a venture capitalist, I think globally, and if I'm wrong, I'm off by a few percent, 5% of the people buy online. In the U.S., it's what, 11, 12?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a little over that, yeah.
And so you want to move and go get the bigger piece of it. Mm-hmm. That's going to require a fairly significant behavior change.
Yes.
Talk about how you're thinking about that and how you're going to tackle it.
So, you know, when you think about in-store payments, it's harder than online and mobile, because in the online and mobile world, when PayPal got started, we solved a real problem. I mean, people wanted to buy things from each other on eBay. They had to literally mail a check. And it took a week to get what you wanted. And PayPal was invented, and then, you know, you could exchange payments without sharing your credit card details or your bank details. And so we solved a real problem. Offline, it's harder, because there's no real problem in paying. Just paying with a credit card, debit card, cash, there are tons of alternatives. So the way we're looking at this from a real problem-solving point of view is really going after those painful use cases in the real, you know, offline world, which are waiting in line, then ordering, then waiting for the stuff you order to get ready. It's when you're at a restaurant, just, you know, waving your hand for 10 minutes to get a check. So all of these experiences we're now building inside of the PayPal app in partnership with EPOS vendors and Discover in the US. And we just launched with Jamba Juice a solution that enables you from your PayPal app to check in at the Jamba Juice before you get there, order your drinks, customize it with your, you know, boosts and whatever you want. And by the time you get there, the drink is waiting for you. It's on the counter. They see you and recognize you because your photo is on their point of sale system. You just grab your drink and you go. This is real, you know, world problem solving. And we feel that the payments offline is not the problem. It's what happens before and after. And that's what we're focusing on.
So I can walk into a Jamba Juice today. How many Jamba Juices have put in the infrastructure to let them do that?
So we're just starting, but our plan is that within this year, it's going to spread across all of the thousands of Jamba Juice across the country. And the beauty in the way we're doing this is that there's no need to rip out the existing infrastructure because we partner with the EPOS vendors to integrate within the existing systems.
So I was fascinated when you took me through the restaurant example, and I think everybody here would enjoy hearing it. We've all sat there and tried to be polite. We're at the end of the evening and we've had a glass of wine and we want to get the hell out of Dodge. How are you going to make that problem easier for us?
So the way we're doing this is you're going to be able to, the same way you're going to be able to check in at the Jamba Juice and order your drink, or check in at the restaurant, and then when you look at your app.
Let me stop you a minute. I check in, I've got an iPhone.
Yep.
I touch an app.
So you launch the PayPal app and it'll ask you, are you at that restaurant?
And I say yes.
And you say yes, and you open a commerce session with the restaurant.
So now the restaurant knows I'm at that session?
Yes.
How does it know that?
Because on the point of sale system, it knows, it sees you, your photo, your name.
So when I click on the app, it goes to their infrastructure.
Exactly.
And my picture is now on their system.
Exactly. And the way they do it then is they link your identity to the table number you're at. And as you order things, you can see in the app the order, you know, the starters or main courses, whatever you are ordering, the drinks, it builds up in the app. And when you're ready to close your check, you just click a button, add a tip, and you leave.
You don't have to wait for a bill. I'm just sitting there. I say, it's time to go. Click 15%, 20%.
Correct.
Looked at it, I've ordered, I walk out.
Exactly. That's what we're building, and we're going to start piloting and launching at greater scale in the second half of this year.
All right, so right now this is an unusual opportunity, and before I ask the question, let me ask the audience a question. Mobile payments we're going to take as a given, but we're really now talking about mobile wallets. How many people here have made at least one transaction with a mobile wallet of any kind? About a third. How many of you are thinking about that that's something you will do in the future? Have you bought into it? All right, now this is the early adopter crowd, and it's, you know, if there weren't a lot of hands here, we'd be scared to death. So you've got something going on here that doesn't usually happen, which is you've got a market which is starting, and all of your competitors are really big elephants. I don't know the numbers, but you've got Verizon, AT&T, T-Mobile in the US with ISIS. What is it, V.me? You got MasterCard with, what is it, iPass or? And that's unusual to have that many people, at least verbally, committed and seeing this opportunity, which doesn't yet exist. It's a coming market. How are you gonna deal with that?
Well, it does exist. I mean, we have 122 million active users at PayPal, and I think
I'm talking about offline.
Yeah, but you need to get the what people call the wallet is de facto what the founders of PayPal have created, you know, 14 years ago, And you know, if you'd ask the question, actually, how many people here in this room have a PayPal account, right? So, and how many people here in this room have any of the alternative mobile payment wallets? So, you know,
10%. Yeah.
The idea here is that it's really, really hard because people don't wake up in the morning and say, I need a mobile wallet. I'm going to sign up for one. It doesn't happen that way. And you need to be in the payment flow to acquire consumers. Once you have enough consumers with payment credentials inside of your wallet, you can then convince merchants that you know, they should accept you because you're going to increase sales or drive new buyers, et cetera. But it's really, really hard to acquire that user base and then to have the merchants do the integration work. So it's definitely the hot buzzword of the year, mobile wallets, the hot term of the year. But it's really, really hard to execute. And then you've got all of the compliance realities if you want to operate in a bunch of different markets. And the barrier of entry is high. So that doesn't mean that we feel really comfortable in our position and that we're not on our toes. And the examples I gave you of fixing real-life problems shows how much we care about innovating and fixing real consumer problems to ensure that we win that battle. But we feel good about it.
So let's talk about, we've talked about the credit card companies. There's another set of people kind of behind the scene. And this is kind of what keeps you up at night question. You mentioned you had 160 million?
122 million.
122 million. Uh-huh. I think Apple has 450 or 500 mm-hmm. million
cards on file.
People who have an iPhone and have an account that we buy something from the iTunes store, et cetera, et cetera. How much do you worry about them?
So I think, you know, the key thing is not having accounts. It's really easy. If you look at the ecosystem of people that have their own closed ecosystem, and Apple is one of them, it's one thing to actually process transaction for your own ecosystem in a controlled environment. It's another to process transactions with multiple third parties shipping physical items. Because then you need to manage, you know, I bought something and it's not what I expected, it arrived broken, it's delayed, and you have to take care of all of those problems, there's a dispute. And this is very, very hard, especially if you get out of the digital goods space and open up a walled garden that's, you know, fairly controlled. So it's hard, and we're thinking of those platforms as, you know, potential partners in expanding those capabilities and those experiences inside of the OS platform going forward.
Just to test the number, who here, maybe I should ask it this way, doesn't have an iTunes account? So, yeah. I didn't see any hands. Mm-hmm. So my business is venture capital, and it has been for 25 years, and you've done 4 startups. Mobile wallet, the way I think about it, is it's a new platform. And in the history of the Silicon Valley ethos, anytime you've had a new platform, you've almost never had an incumbent dominate it. You know, when I came to the Valley, we had IBM. It was called Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And then we went through the mini computer revolution. We had 100 mini computer companies, came down to Hewlett Packard, and then we had the personal computer. I told you the story earlier of Apple taking over Hewlett Packard's corporate headquarters. You have names like Google, Facebook, et cetera, et cetera. Why aren't we gonna sit here 5 years from now and talk about XYZ and say, you know, we didn't see that coming? Mm-hmm.
Well, A, because we're going to really execute really, really well. So that's number one. And if we don't, then it'll happen, no doubt. But I think, you know, payments is a little different in the sense that, again, compliance can be a real pain in the neck to manage at the global scale. And we operate in 196 countries. It's really hard to remain compliant in 196 countries. And, you know, when you build a new search engine, when you build a new social network. There are some aspect of legal and compliance, but it's not, you know, it's not at the same level as when you're managing money and transactions for hundreds of millions of people. So it's hard. But again, that being said, we're very paranoid in nature, and we're very focused in execution. So, you know, again, we feel good about our ability to continue leading the space.
It's actually interesting. Running four startups, you have to wake up paranoid.
Yes, so that's absolutely.
That's a great thing to bring to the company. Two more questions, I think, and we're going to run out of time. You've got a delicate relationship because your credit card companies are great partners for you in the business that you dominate. Mm-hmm. And now you're going to turn around and effect attack them in the offline business, which is the bigger piece of the pie. Yeah. And I'm using those words, it might not be appropriate. How do you think about that?
No, I don't think it's any different than what we're doing online. I think, you know, online, you can add any of your credit cards, whether it's a Visa, MasterCard, American Express, Discover card, to your PayPal wallet de facto and use it on any site or on any mobile site. And we just want to ensure that we can help our customers shop wherever they want to shop. With whatever they want to pay. And so it's the same thing. We're just expanding offline. And they might see it as something that's more threatening, but I don't see it that way. I think that we can actually help them deliver more value to their customers if they play along.
We're going to run out of time, but I'm comfortable with you having my credit card. Mm-hmm. I'm not comfortable giving my credit card to every site that I go into, which is why we use PayPal. Mm-hmm. But I don't know how I feel about it when I walk into a store. I'm trained to put my credit card down and it works.
Yep.
And that's their business, and there's going to be some threat here.
Well, let me tell you, I mean, when you think about security, it's table stakes, but at the same time, it's really important. And this is a true story. Between mid-December and mid-January, the two main credit cards I use got, you know, skimmed or hacked, and I had to replace them, and it was a painful exercise as always. When you are going to use PayPal at point of sale, you don't actually use one of your cards physically. So if something gets hacked, it's actually it's a PayPal card, it's going to be a PayPal card, but you can turn it off and automatically reprovision a new one because it's a dumb token. So from a security standpoint, we're going to take it up a notch and then add a ton of functionality on top of that. So you're still going to be able to use any funding source you want, any credit cards you want, but you'll have added functionality and security using PayPal.
So my summary would be, and thank you very much for doing this.
Thank you.
There hasn't been a lot of innovation at PayPal, let's say, for the last 5 years. Mm-hmm. You've talked about a lot of new innovation you're bringing. That seems to be the contribution you're bringing to the company besides making them think like a startup.
Yeah, I'd like to think so. I think, you know, the past 4 or 5 years has been all about scaling the company and making sure that, you know, we can scale compliance and keep the bad guys out of the system and accept more customers and more transactions. And the next 5 years are all about innovation and creating delightful and amazing consumer experiences for our 122 million customers and soon 200 million.
The red zeros have lit up. We've got to quit. David, thank you for doing this.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.